What are the commonalities among leaders who sustain excellence over an extended period of time? Debbie, it's so great to have you here on the Learning Leaders Show. Welcome.
Thank you, Ryan. It's really great to be here.
Let me get practical for a second, Debbie, and take a little left-hand turn. So there's a lot of people that I work with and that are probably watching, listening, that are they're in some sort of leadership role within a company. And part of their activities is they are giving, they're doing like quarterly business reviews, they're doing town halls. And as a part of those, they may build a PowerPoint deck, and they're usually given a deck and like, hey, fill in the numbers. And every once in a while, I find a person who throws that deck in the trash and they create their own of these beautiful images and use of design to actually tell a better story. And I love it when I see that, and I try to do it myself. What advice would you give to that person who's given a deck and that they're told to fill in the numbers and everything else as they give their QBR? And maybe there's a better way. And I'm not trying to lead the witness here, but I'm thinking, you know, you
yes,
might
you
might
are.
Have some thoughts.
Yes, you are.
what do you think is a better way to go about doing these types of reviews and reports?
Well, usually those types of reviews and reports are more for the orator as opposed to the audience.
Yes.
And so what it becomes for the audience is remedial reading, because all you're getting is somebody reciting what is on the slide in front of them.
Right.
And if that's what it is, you're wasting your time. People will check out because they can read a lot faster than somebody's actually speaking. And so they'll read it. The person is still speaking. And at that point, maybe they're 3/4 of the way through reading. The other person that's in the audience is done reading. And that's when they pick up their phone. So I think that slides should be used for directional guidance. Just one bullet point with one statement or one image, and let that enhance what you're saying, not prescribe what you're saying or reflect what you're saying.
So how do you coach people on this stuff? Do you ever work with clients on things like this?
I work with my students, but I don't work with clients in that way. No.
So what are some things you tell your students? Because you're like preparing them for this life that they're going to fall into, and they may think, oh, what do I do? Debbie, my teacher told me to do this, but now everyone else does this. What should I do?
Well, a big part of what I try to teach my students is how to make an effective presentation.
Yeah.
And you have to really relentlessly prepare. You have to prepare and visualize every scenario. First of all, you have to know something that you're speaking about so thoroughly that somebody could wake you up in the middle of the night and ask you about it, and you would be able to answer without notes and without prompts. So you really need to know what you're talking about. A lot of people don't really, really know what they're talking about.
They need the slides just to read, yeah.
They need to be reminded. That's one of the really interesting things about teaching, is that it forces you to learn your topic.
Yeah.
And so you have to visualize every scenario. You have to be able to anticipate any question that you might be asked. You have to anticipate for somebody understanding, somebody not understanding, somebody liking what you're saying and agreeing with you, and somebody not, and what the various responses are going to be. Because the last thing you want to be in a presentation is defensive about what you're saying, because the minute you do that, you're going to lose everyone who then suddenly doesn't trust what you're saying and what you stand for. You know, ideas are in many ways very easy. Strategy is a lot harder. You know, I can ask anybody to come up with a new idea for just about anything, and they'd probably be able to have 5 ideas in 15 minutes. But to really have a strategic point of view about those ideas, so a reason for being to bring those ideas to life, that's a lot harder. And so you really need to be able to understand what it is you want to convey to your audience, and then create a narrative arc to be able to do that.
That just takes a lot of
People
work.
People don't create narrative arcs. They just have, this is the information I want to communicate. And then they have 15 slides with 500 words on each slide. And by the time people are finished, they want to just, you know, kill themselves. So you really want to be able to understand that every presentation is really a performance. and you're performing this information for people in a way that needs to be compelling, that needs to be persuasive, that needs to be open to other points of view, that needs to be able to be challenged, and that needs to inspire people. And if you can't do that, and if you can't answer how you're going to do that as you prepare for every presentation, then you haven't really earned the right to present yet.
Yeah, and I sense the reason that that's not the norm is because it's hard. It takes a lot of time and people are busy. And so they think, well, let's fill in the gaps of, I mean, I've done this, so I'm not like I have too.
You know, that's why
because we have all these other things, but, oh, I got to get that presentation, man. I'm not sure. Oh, and I think that's why we do it. And yet though, then it's such a painful exercise for everybody, because we have to sit through everyone else's who did the same thing. Right. And we're thinking, why do we do this to ourselves? There could be a better way. It takes more time up front, but the end result, like most things in life, is so much more worth it.
Right. Well, leaders are people that have achieved something.
Yeah.
And when they have reached that pinnacle in their lives, they think that they can wing more things. And so they'll rely on their existing success to propel them into another success. But people always know when you're winging something, just like they always know when you're not telling the truth. But somehow, because leaders are leaders and they think they're a leader because they're smarter than everybody, and they very well may be smarter than most, it still doesn't take away from the fact that people are highly empathic and have senses about when somebody's telling the truth or if they really, really don't know what they're talking about. My goddaughter, years and years ago, like 20 years ago, when she was first learning about computers, she was in grade school at the time. She was super excited about it because she knew that I spent all of my time on a computer, and she was trying to tell me what she learned. And she was having a really difficult time expressing herself. And she was stammering and just hemming and hawing. And finally, she looked at me and she said, one of the most brilliant things anybody has ever said to me in my life. She looked at me and she said, "Debbie, life is so difficult when you don't know what you're talking about." And it's so true.
Sometimes the simplicity of a kid or right? someone who just says it, it's like, yes, that's the thing. That's it.
That is the thing. We make life more difficult for ourselves when we try to talk about things that we don't necessarily know about, but we feel compelled to talk about, and then get caught up in a whole series of spirals that end up in a downward spiral toward shame.
Yeah. You mentioned something earlier where you said teaching forces you to learn your topic. So I've been really pulling on this thread lately, Debbie, because I think when I work with leaders, I will always push them to teach. And sometimes I say, I don't even care what you teach. Sign up at your place of work to whether it's teach like a little mini elective or call it whatever you want, teach a class. Maybe it's to help. It helps to start with something like you really care about, you're really passionate about, because what happens in that process is all of the prep, all of the work, all of the, like, I need to get very clear on what I believe before I'm going to share it with someone else because I want to add value. Then you do the teaching and then you get the feedback afterwards. This loop, I think teaching could be the greatest tool in the world for learning. I sense this is what you've gathered through all
Absolutely,
of
Absolutely, Ryan. I have to tell you. So I decided... this semester, one of my faculty is only able to teach 12 of his 15 classes. It's a once a week class for 15 weeks. And I have been dying to teach a class on capitalism, on the history of capitalism. And so I decided I was going to fill in those 3 weeks with a little introductory course for my new students called Introduction to Capitalism. And as I've been teaching for 15 years, and I teach business strategy and I teach all sorts of classes on branding. And so I kind of thought I understood capitalism and I understood its origin and so on and so forth. The more I got into the history of capitalism, the more I realized I can't teach a history of capitalism without teaching history of feudalism. And then I also need to be able to teach something about Marxism and socialism. And there goes sort of this minefield of incredible topics that I need to be able to make sure I understand the conditions that led to the conditions that brought about our world of the free market, so to speak. So yeah, it's a really incredible exercise to be going through and really understanding what it takes to master a topic.
Yeah, and this is just why I would continue to reiterate and push this. I know you're busy. I know people have a lot going on, but forcing yourself, creating forcing functions for you to teach, to be in the mode of a teacher is when so much learning will happen. Debbie, I've scoured the world to find some of the most fascinating quotes from you. And I would love to, and some of them may be older than others, but sometimes we do this and we have some fun with it because you're like, oh, I've changed a little bit, or yes, I believe it in some. So if you're cool with it, I'd love to surface if maybe a couple of them, and then we can flesh them out a little bit. Is that cool?
Absolutely.
So this one really caught my eye. You said, by the way, if I found quotes that are not accurate, you can tell me that too. But hopefully they are. So you said, I once read that the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over and expecting different results. I fundamentally disagree with this idea. I think that doing the same thing over and over and expecting different results is the definition of hope. What do you think?
Well, you know, not to diss Mr. Einstein in any way, I still maintain that there's a part of that that's true. I do think that we can run into some difficulties by continuing to do something over and over again and expecting a different result. I think the key to it being hope is doing it slightly differently. Mm-hmm. So you can still do the same thing, but I wouldn't recommend that you do the same thing in the exact same way, because otherwise, I think you do run the risk of failing in a way that is more painful.
Iterate, you're saying.
You can fail and learn, iterate and grow and evolve. Then chances are much stronger that you will be able to create some different scenario. But if you do the exact same thing in the exact same way into the exact same circumstances, I don't really know what could possibly be different in an outcome. So I think I do have to nod to Mr. Einstein and say, yes, there is something fundamentally true about that, certainly in an empirical scientific manner, but in a more abstract manner, in a more artistic manner, I think doing the same thing over and over again and learning from what you're doing and iterating based on that learning creates mastery.
Gotcha. Is there like an example that you can think of when it comes to that, where you're doing it over and over with little iterations as you're learning through some minor failures or setbacks to then get to a point that you feel good about?
The first example I can think of is Jackson Pollock. There's a really great movie about Jackson Pollock. Marsha Gay Harden is in it and Ed Harris is in it. And Ed Harris, you see a lot of his working through to his ultimate sort of understanding of what his abstract paintings need to be and what they stand for. And there's this moment where he creates the splash painting, the splatter painting. And Marsha Gay Harden's character, Lee Krasner, says to him, I think you're onto something. I think you've broken through to something. And I think that that is a really wonderful understanding of experimenting over and over with the same sort of variations on a theme and him getting to a place where he has that breakthrough. I don't think those breakthroughs come unless you are constantly iterating your ideas and challenging your own ideas and growing your own ideas. And that's when I think an original idea happens.
Hmm. Okay. I like that. Let's talk about branding.
Okay.
So you said a brand is simply a set of beliefs. And if you don't create a set of beliefs around your products or services, well, you stand for nothing. You have no values, no vision. So let's expand on brand. And I want to take this two ways. One, from like a company perspective, like Nike's got a brand or whoever, Burger King, I know you've worked with them or others. But then there's also the brand of Debbie Millman or the brand of person A over here who has a job as a leader within a company. Can you maybe hit both of those branding when it comes to a company or a product or a service, as well as your personal brand, the brand of a person?
So that's a really, really interesting question, Ryan. And I'm going to have to sort of deconstruct it okay. in a bunch of different ways. Fundamentally, for me, I consider branding to be manufactured meaning. We imbue a thing with a sensibility. So we have a brand and we give it attributes and we give it identifiers and we allow people to understand what that thing is through a transfer of communication. That communication could include symbols, it could include language, it could include behavior. But fundamentally, that brand doesn't exist without human interaction embedding a series of characteristics or attributes into that thing. Now, I contend that all of religion is that as well. It's manufactured meaning. Religions don't grow on trees. They don't spring up from the earth. We create a set of beliefs that we then articulate through a whole series of behaviors, symbols, and attributes. Now, as far as considering me or anyone a brand, I find that to be problematic. I find anyone aspiring to be a brand to be then saying, I am going to manufacture a persona that I am going to project out that I hope you're going to believe. No one is the same every single day. Brands aspire for consistency. Yes, they can evolve and grow, but when they do, they need a strategy to do that. I think humans need to evolve more organically, and they grow and change. They fall in love, they fall out of love. They gain weight, they lose weight. They color their hair, they cut their hair. There's any number of things. If you have to start assessing how you change based on how your audience is going to feel about those changes, you cease to be a person with your own organic humanity. And so I think that humans develop their character, they develop their reputation. But to think of a human developing their brand, unless you're selling something specific, like a makeup line that has your name on it, then that's a branded product that you own and develop. But the minute you consider your heart beating self a brand, I think you dilute your humanity.
It's interesting though, because I think of like Debbie Millman's a brand. Like I've heard it. I've taught friends who brought your name up. I thought I wanted you to be on this for a while because of everything you've created and done and the way you think. So
well, I would like to hope that's more about my humanity.
Absolutely.
I've changed a lot over the time that I've been a professional. Came out 10 years ago. I now have my own practice versus heading up a huge branding consultancy. You know, a lot of people would have said when I had the opportunity to be the CEO of the organization that I was president of, that was more in line with my brand, but that wasn't more in line with how I wanted to live my life.
Interesting.
And so I think that I'm hoping that you're responding more to my reputation than my planning the evolution of my brand.
Gotcha. Okay. I understand like the differences here. I've seen, I mean, you see them advertised, go to this workshop to work on your personal brand. I don't think there's ill intentions there.
No, I don't think so either.
It's about kind of cultivating, I guess, their work or what they're trying to, but I understand from your perspective of where you're seeing that of, if it doesn't feel genuine, maybe, or not authentic to who you are, because humans are, I think humans in general are, the world's gray, it's not black and white, and people are messy.
Yes.
And I think that's the thing about whenever I'm sure this as a podcast host and as a, you're a person of fame, every once in a while you meet somebody and they have these expectations that you don't have any flaws, that right. you are perfect. And that sometimes for me is a bummer, because I'm like, that is just not true.
Not
like,
the case.
There's like a million flaws and there's so much messiness here. Even if you've developed this sense of listening to a podcast and you don't feel that, or you don't see that for some reason.
Right.
And, but in reality, like, no, it's there. I promise you, you know?
Yeah. I mean, Instagram in a lot of ways yep. is manufactured meaning. You're creating a persona that you want people to see.
Highlight reel. Yeah.
Right. And
for the most part.
I think that you're 100%. I mean, I've said it before myself, so we are completely in agreement. Life is messy. Humans are messy. That's not what we want our brands to be. That's when we criticize our brands.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Actually, and ironically, people are not really interested in a new brand form or flavor as much as they are interested in how a brand can change, impact, or improve their lives.
Correct.
They want brands around them that make them feel special and provide some social cachet or confidence. How about that one?
Well, I was with you 100% until that word confidence.
Okay.
My views on confidence have really evolved over the years. Mm-hmm. I think that people do seek out brands that they think will improve their confidence. And for a brief period of time, they will, but we metabolize that feeling very quickly. We metabolize all our feelings. We metabolize feelings of hunger. We metabolize feelings of being full. And we, you know, we think after Thanksgiving, we never want to eat again. And 4 hours later, we're picking through the refrigerator for leftovers. So we metabolize everything. We live on a planet that is constantly metabolizing. And so what ends up happening is we think we need this thing to be more confident or to be equal to others, when in fact, they're just placeholders. And they're giving us this feeling for a little while. You know, Dan Pink would say, if your idea of happiness is a certain inch flat screen TV, you're playing a fool's game, because once we have that thing, we're going to metabolize the feelings of delight and thrill until it becomes sort of ordinary and part of our everyday experience. I mean, I can ask anybody that's listening, as soon as you got your last promotion, what were you thinking you wanted for your next? When did you start thinking about your next promotion or your next raise? You know, we think we need these things to be happy. And then once we get them, we tend to then want more, because that view of happiness is actually really, really flimsy. We rely on it for sort of day-to-day buoying up of our confidence, so to speak. But confidence really comes from within, and it comes from successful repetition of any endeavor. Mm-hmm. And so it really doesn't come from outside stimuli unless you are engaged in that stimuli on a regular basis and feel predictively that you can assess that the next time you do something, you will be able to do it well. You know, we all have car confidence after driving for a year or so. We have walking confidence if we're able to walk. We don't think about these things. They're more sort of operational to us now. Yeah. But when we start doing something is when we're looking for confidence. And sometimes we wait to feel more confident before we're willing to do it, when in fact, what we need in that moment is actually courage to take the first step into the confidence. And then when we do it enough times, we can then build the confidence, which really is just the predictive ability to view the future with our doing something and doing it well.
I really identify with that. Of you set like a, it's like the guidepost here, and then you hit it. Like, I remember getting a book deal and thinking leading up to, like, there's no way I could ever do that.
Right.
And you do it. And you do it again, and like friends give you champagne and other things. And I still think of like the champagne sitting in my cabinet, hasn't even been opened right. because there was a new thing further out instantly.
Yeah.
And so, and I read this quote recently, I forget. I mean, it's probably been said by a lot of different people, but the quote is, it's not about what you acquire. It's about who you become in the process of acquiring it. And that's the thing. Like, that's really what the thing is, I feel like.
Yeah, that's beautiful. That is absolutely beautiful.
Yeah.
I think that is exactly right. One question that I'm really endlessly fascinated with these days is, how long does the feeling of accomplishment last for someone?
How about for you? Like, you've had some massive accomplishments. You've been named to all these things, books, everything, right? I mean, you got it all. I mean, I what did it feel like when you're being named like the most creative person in the world by all of these name brands? I mean, you're all over the place. Like, what are these? Do they just hit you and then you move on, or like, how does that go?
Isn't that tragic? Yeah.
Is that really how it goes? Like,
yeah, but I don't know anybody that doesn't experience that ephemeralness of, if that's a word, of success.
Yeah.
So many, especially because I interview so many people. Yeah. You know, they're always searching to grow and develop. And I think that's part of that metabolizing. We metabolize our successes in the same way that, you know, people say when you're grieving, well, it takes time to get over the grief. Well, it's interesting because it doesn't take a lot of time to get over the success. We're constantly looking for more, new, better. And I find that anybody I ask that question to now is within minutes, within a day, you know, I don't think anybody's even said more than a week.
Yeah. It's interesting how that works. Yeah. Before we go, I did want to ask you a question about interviewing, because when I am lucky enough to talk to someone as brilliantly as you, who also has spent a great deal of time interviewing people, you have one of the original podcasts, has been in existence from the beginning, it seems like. What's your desire / motivation, overall feeling around interviewing other people?
I love it. Mm-hmm. Again, endlessly fascinated with how people become who they are. I'm so captivated by how humans overcome obstacles, how they manage their own grief and pain, desires, ambition. How people become who they are, especially when they are considered masters at something, is, I think, the greatest journey of our species. You know, how do we imagine our lives into creation? And then how do we make them what we want them to be? It's a gift. It's a gift.
So what made you start it so long ago? Like, you are way, way before most or almost all.
I did a Hail Mary with my career at that point. I had been working in branding at that point for 10 years. Mm-hmm. And I was, for the first time in my life, successful at something. I was already in my 40s at that point. And I had an opportunity to host this little radio show on a fledgling internet radio network that was just starting back in 2004. And they approached me at the end of 2004 after an article I had written on Speak Up with my friend Mark Kingsley sort of went viral on election graphics and the branding of election graphics. And they called me and they wanted me to host a radio show on branding. But because I was doing so much work day to day in branding, and I had, for the first time in my life, felt successful at it, I had all but given up all of my side projects and anything purely creative, not commercially creative. And I thought, oh, here's an opportunity. Maybe I can do something really creative and do something just with design, and convince them to let me do a show that was on design, as long as I included some branding, which, you know, of course you have to with design on some level. And so that's when Design Matters was born. The first show aired February 4th, 2005. And my friend Bryony Gomez-Palacio, who was one of the co-founders of Speak Up, was lamenting to me the limited amount of time that was available for people to listen to the show. I broadcast it live on a Friday afternoon, and then you had an opportunity to re-listen to it one other time in Voice America's schedule in the wee hours of the morning. And she said, why don't you upload it to iTunes? And I was like, oh, what a good idea. And, you know, I did that like 2 or 3 months later, I think in June of 2005, and the podcast was born. I don't even know if the word podcast was in use at the time or it was just barely in use. There was definitely no podcast section on iTunes. It was almost like I was an indie musician.
Oh, I was going to say, like, what were even the other podcasts that existed? I'm not even sure.
Wikipedia has a list now of the podcasts that were founded in 2004 and 2005. And I think every year since, but the list I think begins in 2004.
Are like how many are even still in existence? There can't be too many.
There are about, I think from that time, about five that are still.
Really? Wow. What does that feel like for you? I mean, that's different because this is not a landmark. This is a mark of consistency and effort and work. Stacking days, like what does that feel like? I feel like that's different.
I'm proud of it. Really proud of it. I have a book coming out in October. Which is sort of a best of. It's sort of a monograph of the show, and I had to pick. I couldn't include every interview because of space, so I have about 60 condensed interviews, and then another 60 sort of full page quotes, and it was an opportunity to go through every show and read all the transcripts and really relive the last 16 years in a way that surprised me. It also mortified me a bit to understand just how terrible I was at the beginning.
How long? Like, was there a mark here where you felt like, okay, I'm kind of getting the hang here?
There's two marks.
Okay.
I would say the first 100 episodes of Design Matters are unlistenable. Really, truly unlistenable. The sound quality was terrible and I was terrible. And so in 2009, I started working with my producer who I work with, Curtis Fox. He started producing the show. And so that's one big marker where the first 100 shows, he's been 101 forward. The first 100 shows, don't even bother. And then I would say between 2009 and 2015, I was really finding my feet as an interviewer. I think you can see sort of the growth. And then I would say from 2015 to now, I think I've been able to sort of bring my full self as an interviewer to every interview that I do, or to most.
This could take an hour, so I understand that. But what are the core qualities / behaviors of an excellent interviewer?
There are a couple. The first is you really have to listen. Most people, when they're in a conversation, don't really listen. They talk, then they stop talking. They wait for the other person to stop talking so they can start talking again. That's just human nature. So really being able to focus on who I'm interviewing is critical. And I do that by trying to research everything I possibly can on my guests so that whatever they say, I can have something to be able to continue the conversation about it being about them. You know, usually conversations tend to be back, forth, back, forth, back, forth. I like to see my conversations and my interviews as narrative arcs where I'm continually allowing my guests to speak about their life. So it's not they're saying something and then I'm opinionating on what they're saying. They're saying something, and because of what I know about what they're saying, it allows me to then ask more questions about what they're saying because I have the information and the research to help propel us forward. So I sort of see a great interview like a game of pool, billiards. You know, when you're playing a game of pool, the object is to get as many of the billiard balls into the pockets. So you do that by wanting to not only get the ball into the pocket, but also leave the other billiard balls in a position on the table to be able to continue the game. And that's sort of how I feel a great conversation or interview, which is different from a conversation. The great interview is where you're able to follow wherever your guest goes because you know that much about who they are.
The over preparation frees you up to be agile in the moment, I sense.
Absolutely. So I'll spend, you know, at least 10, 15 hours preparing for any interview. You know, I just interviewed Ricky Lee Jones, one of my idols, and she has a new memoir out. I happen to already own her entire catalog of music, but I read the memoir. I really enveloped myself into her world for the last 2 weeks so that I interviewed her yesterday. When I was face to face with her, I would be able to have a conversation that really honored her work and gave her the sense that everything she said mattered to the interview.
So cool. That's the best when you get to kind of meet your heroes and they live up to it. It's the best. Oh, God. The best. Cool. The new book, Why Design Matters. So I was looking online about this. So you said though there's some condensed interviews within some. I just want to see it. I want to hold it. I'm excited for that moment. Can you share the actual makeups of the book and why we should be so excited about it? I mean, I am, but I want to hear more about it from you.
Well, there are 5 essays in the book also, which I'm really happy about. I wrote an essay about sort of the history of the show and how it happened and high moments, low moments, and so forth. Tim Ferriss wrote a great, great introduction for me. God bless him. He is just a fairy godfather. my wife wrote one, Roxane Gay. Maria Popova wrote one, my dear, dear friend from Brain Picking. She wrote a remarkable essay on what it means to live a life and sort of reflect on a life at the same time. Zach Pettit, who was the former editor-in-chief of Print Magazine, wrote a remarkable essay for me. And Steve Heller, the great design historian. So there's those, which are just worth reading because they're so wonderful. And then, as I said, 60 interviews. I wrote this book during COVID and I had a deadline. And I was intending initially to do a vast photo shoot with the guests that I chose to include, but obviously I couldn't do that. So I ended up photo editing the book myself and worked with really amazing photographers to go deep into their catalogs to find really remarkable photos. Every single photo had to have a common denominator, even though they were different photographers. And that common denominator is soul. Mm. So when you look at the photo, you feel like you're looking into the mind of the person. And it was really hard to do that, but I think I did.
What are some of the pictures that you chose?
Well, the guests include...
Of the guests. Okay, so you actually did have the photographers. I thought you meant like they were just taking like in nature.
Because of
COVID. Okay.
Yeah, no, yeah. I couldn't do a photo shoot. So I had to work individually with photographers to go into their catalogs to get photos.
Wow.
So I worked with 50, 60 photographers.
Wow, that sounds like a lot of work.
But I'm so thrilled that I did it.
Yeah.
Gorgeous, gorgeous photographs. So that is what I feel. It's a coffee table book. It's 10 by 10. It's almost 400 pages. Alex Kalman designed it. So another really interesting story. One of my heroes, as I was a young baby designer growing up, was Tibor Kalman, the late great genius, you know, one of the most important designers of the 20th century. And I'm also a huge fan of Myra Kalman, who was his wife, who is still a remarkable illustrator. Well, they had a son named Alex Kalman, who's now, I think, in his 30s. And my agent recommended that I work with Alex. And so Alex Kalman, the son of two of my heroes, two of the people that have influenced my thinking about design and illustration more than anyone really, designed my book.
Wow. So cool. I'm pumped for that thing to read it. All right, Debbie, one last question. You know, there this is for someone maybe who's a little bit earlier in their career. Maybe they graduated college in the last few years. They want to leave a dent in the world in a positive way. They want to impact people in a positive way. They want to leave them better than they found them, right? Those types of people, the ones that we want to hang out with typically. What are some general pieces of life / career advice you would give to them?
Well, I've learned the hard way. Don't edit your hopes and dreams before you even attempt them.
Mm.
You know, going back to this whole idea of courage and confidence, so many people, and I know this because I teach undergraduate college, so many of the seniors that I talk to are already saying, oh, I really can't do that because I'm not good enough. I'm not smart enough. I'm not pretty enough. I'm not thin enough. I'm not this enough. I'm not that enough. And I totally get it because I did the same thing. Like I remember the moment in 1983, standing on the corner of Bleecker Street and Sixth Avenue in Manhattan, thinking, I just don't think I can do that. I think I'm going to do this instead because I think it's easier. Well, nothing is easy. Everything takes hard work. Every job has its hard days, and it, give yourself the opportunity to try it before you refuse to even consider it.
What was the turning point for you after 1983? You're on Bleecker Street. You're like, oh, I don't know about this.
Well, at the time I really wanted to be an artist and a writer. Yeah. And I just couldn't envision how I could ever make that happen. And so I chose commercial art because I knew that I could pay my rent, or at least I could try.
Mm-hmm.
But I've loved what I've done in this career, but the idea of being a writer and an artist never went away. You know, one we could even metabolize grief, but you know what we can't metabolize? You know what we can't metabolize, Ryan?
What?
Regret.
Mm.
There's no closure to regret. So we can't metabolize it. It lives with us forever. And so wouldn't you rather try something and experience the attempt than having to regret not trying for the rest of your life?
Do you have regrets?
Not anymore, but you for did? A long time I did. Yeah.
What? What were they?
Well, not pursuing doing more art, not pursuing writing, not pursuing sort of my own practice. Yeah, all of
so it. When was the moment where you said, I'm not going to have these regrets anymore. I'm going to do something about these regrets.
50.
Was it the number or was it something that happened?
It was the number.
Really?
It was like, if not now, when?
So what happened on your 50th birthday?
I came out.
Wow. Wow. And then what?
And then I felt a lot freer. I felt a lot less judged. I realized that the secrets were killing me and no one else.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I talk about this on Tim Ferriss's show a little bit as well. Shortly thereafter, I started working with Mariska Hargitay at the Joyful Heart Foundation and helped create the No More movement and started to disclose some of my own early experiences that I had always felt ashamed of. Mm-hmm. And that also opened me up to the possibility of evolving and growing in ways that I hadn't experienced. And giving up that shame as well really showed me that I was, that holding myself back was probably the most damaging way to live. Hmm. And so over this last 10 years, things have really changed, I think, quite dramatically. In my psyche and how I approach
I really appreciate you sharing that. Do you think that could have been done at 30?
Not for me. Certainly is for other people. At the time, I didn't have the sort of psychological resources to be able to do that.
Yeah.
Every journey towards, I guess it sounds kind of corny, but, you know, self-actualization is different, you know, and some people get it, you know, they're masters at something in their teens. I mean, I just watched the Olympics and was astounded by the mastery that the teenagers had in the skateboarding and swimming and diving. And I was like, oh my God, This is just incredible. How does that feel to be so amazing at such a young age?
Yeah, I love it. Debbie, thank you so much for sharing. Like, I really appreciate how much like you're willing to just open up and go there. I never know what to expect when you meet somebody that you really looked up to for a long time. You're certainly one of those people for me. So
the
joy when you responded to my first email, I'm not going to lie. I was like, this is sweet. thank you for
Absolutely.
That. I appreciate it. And I am pumped to read Why Design Matters, Conversations thank with you. The World's Most Creative People, coming out in October 26th, I believe, correct?
Yes.
And look at it too, because I know it's going to be beautiful as well. Where else would you send viewers, listeners to learn about you online?
Oh, just debbiemilman.com. That's my website. And it's a little bit outdated, but cobbler shoes kind of thing.
I think it's kind of cool. I was going to ask you who designed it, and I think you did.
Oh, Armin Vick designed it.
Oh, he did. Okay. Yeah. So it's really well done. Well, Debbie, thank you so much again. And I would love to continue our dialogue as we both progress here.
You have one of the greatest radio voices I've heard in a long time. I can talk to you for hours.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And excited to do this again. Thank you.
Thanks, Ryan.
All right.
You.